So welcome to March, everyone. Welcome to the Toronto Jug for March. And we usually get started. I noticed there's a few new faces, a few people who haven't been here in a while. So once again, just a quick reminder, you have to pay for the drinks that you're drinking right now. Some people have forgotten that in previous months, and we like meeting here, so we want everyone to pay for what they consume. Please join our mailing list and our Google Plus community. I think you can reach both of them from our homepage at tjug.ca. And check out our videos. I know a lot of people have been, so that's great. Keep doing it. Thanks to Andrew for once again coming out and doing the videoing for us. So news. As of yesterday, we made it all the way to 20 days since the most recent zero-day exploit for a JDK release. So thanks, Oracle. You can check this nice website. It's called java-zeroday.com, in case you're wondering if you're currently vulnerable. It's a very flippant website, but I think that we need to put a bit more pressure on Oracle to take this seriously, because yes, they've been very good at turning around patches, but no, the Java plugin has not generally been secure for the last 6 months. I'm leading with this now because having put together the slides for these meetings over the last 6 months or so, I don't think there's been a single month gone by since last September that there hasn't been a Java zero-day exploit between meetings. So that's really embarrassing, and maybe the best solution is just get rid of the Java plugin altogether, because it's making us all look silly. So Red Hat has taken the reins on OpenJDK 6. Oracle was formerly responsible, but the person who was doing that at Oracle, Kelly O'Hare, has stepped down and is presumably now focusing on OpenJDK 7 and or 8, both of which are in progress. Andrew Haley from Red Hat has stepped up, and he's now leading the OpenJDK 6 effort. And Oracle does continue to offer commercial support for Oracle JDK 6, which is a different code base from OpenJDK 6. As of Java 7, the code bases are much closer together. And we had a presentation, actually, last year from Deepak Bole, who explained the very convoluted heritage of OpenJDK 6. The short story is OpenJDK 6 is a fork of Sun JDK 6, which is now Oracle JDK 6, whereas OpenJDK 7 is the real trunk of development, and Oracle JDK 7 forks off of that. So the relationship between the two was reversed. And so essentially, if you've got something that works on Oracle JDK 6, it doesn't necessarily work on OpenJDK 6, whereas there's really good correspondence between OpenJDK 7 and Oracle JDK 7 for compatibility. But try your stuff. If you're stuck on 6 for some reason, do try it on OpenJDK 6, because there's a good chance that it'll work. Java EE7 is almost final. All of the component specs that go into the umbrella for Enterprise Edition 7 are now at the executive committee for the final approval, which is usually just kind of a rubber stamp type thing. So EE7 will, as far as we can tell, be available on schedule. Is anyone on EE6 doing like real work with like CDI and JPA 2.0 and that kind of stuff? No? Well, maybe you could. Oh yeah, you guys are. Cool. So it looks like you're in a minority here. But I've been really impressed with EE6, and EE7 looks even better, so it's definitely worth checking out. So there's been a lot of commotion about stack map frames, because someone from Cronon, which is it's called the time traveling debugger, has posted a big nasty blog article about this. So it was an optional feature that first became available in JDK 6, basically speeds up the verifier by having the compiler do some of the verifier's work ahead of time, so that when it comes time to load a class and verify that it's not trying to subvert the type system, a whole bunch of work about what types of variable could possibly be at different points inside of a method has been pre-computed by the compiler. However, if you're instrumenting bytecode at runtime, you have to recalculate this stuff, and there's actually no runtime advantage then if you're like modifying a class for whatever reason as it's being loaded. You have to recompute this stuff so that the verifier can save time, which, since it's already runtime, doesn't really make any sense at all. And so this Cronon developer claims, he's saying, well, almost everybody uses some sort of Java agent these days for something, and so it's just making everything more complicated for actually no net benefit. And you can follow the back and forth argument at the URL that's linked below. Something else, there's Coursera. If you haven't heard of it, they offer free university level courses that you can get a certificate from. One of the very popular ones when Coursera first launched was this Functional Programming Principles in Scala, offered by Martin Odersky, who's both a computer science professor and the creator of the Scala language and maintainer of the Scala compiler. My coworker Christian took this course last time it was offered on Coursera, and he said it was really excellent, high quality course, worth doing. So if you have any interest in functional programming and or Scala, you should check this out. Other stuff, I forgot to put in, I'm wearing the t-shirt, Google Summer of Code is accepting applications up until, I don't know, tomorrow or something. So if you're doing any kind of open source projects at your business, even if it's not your main line of work, if you have some stuff that's open source, you can apply to Google to get them to pay summer students to work for 4 months on your project. And all you have to do is offer mentorship. They don't have to be local, they're usually remote. Google will pay them, I think it's $4,000 over the course of the summer to work on your open source project. I participated as a mentor last year, so I got the shirt. It was a great experience. My student was in Hungary. He basically finished a Jenkins plugin that I was writing, and he's still leading the project. I gave it to him, he's doing great. It's been a really positive experience for me and him. So I do recommend, if there's any, even like in your spare time you're doing something, do take the time tomorrow to apply as an organization. So without further ado, we'll present Adib.
So thank you for being here. My name is Adib Saikali. I'm the presenter tonight, and I work for a local company called VentureLinks, where we've got an application for entrepreneurs to share and organize their information with all their investors and their advisors. So we built that application on top of enterprise Java with Spring and a variety of other really cool technologies. And in the process, you know, we came to the conclusion that embedding Tomcat was probably something that we should do. So that's the title of this presentation, Teach Your Tomcat Embedding Tricks. And what we're going to do is really talk about two things. First, I really want everybody to be convinced that you should be embedding Tomcat always. The whole idea of deploying things to the app server is brain dead. I'll tell you why as we go through this presentation. So if you're doing that, hopefully I'll convince you that you shouldn't be. Okay, so that's my really opinionated opinion about that. And then the second thing is to talk about how to actually accomplish the task of embedding Tomcat. And then all the slides and the code that I'm going to show you tonight are on Bitbucket. If you just go to that link, you'll be able to get it all. For my curiosity, how many people are using Tomcat in production right now? Okay, so quite a few people. Hopefully this will be useful. So the first primary reason why you should consider embedding Tomcat is very simply that it simplifies your development environment. All of us that use Eclipse probably love to hate WTP because of all the times that it fails in publishing and a variety of other ills that it has. So if you want a setup whereby by just checking something out of source control, everything works without you having to configure anything, that would be pretty cool, right? But in order to do that, you'd have to download Tomcat, install Tomcat, you'd have to configure it, typically like install a JDBC driver into the Tomcat lib. Maybe if you have, you know, AspectJ load time weaving turned on, you might have to copy a bunch of files into lib. Now you can script all those, but then there's the step that you can't script, which is to configure Tomcat in your IDE. You gotta go to preferences, to add server, add Tomcat, and tell Eclipse all about it. Or tell IntelliJ, which I'm not familiar with how that one works. So if you use embedded Tomcat, you just check the code out, and it works. There's nothing to do. There's no server to set up. So let me just give you a demo of that. And here it is. So let's go here. So in this example here, I've got this code that's checked out of the project that I linked to on the Bitbucket. So if I want to run my copy of Tomcat here, I just go to demo main, run as Java application. And that is going to come back with a fully functioning Tomcat server. So imagine you just check out your code from source control and that's all you do. Right? Anybody would like to have that? So that's one reason, number one, for wanting to run. Let me prove to you that it works. So we're going to go to localhost 8080 here. And there is a special servlet. I won't talk to you about the output of it yet, but this will show you what happens to the class loaders when you actually have an embedded Tomcat, because you don't get the same class loader hierarchy by default. But we'll talk about that once we get to the how part. So that's demo one. And then continuing along, the second reason why you would want to do this is branching. Who uses branches and tags for their releases? Right, so imagine this scenario. You've already got a release 2.0, which was using Tomcat 7.0.25. You now have a Tomcat 2.1 release, which is using, let's say Tomcat 7.035. And then you have your current development branch that's on Tomcat 7.0.37. All right, that could reflect your reality, perhaps. And then you get a customer bug report. You got a customer that's running your version 2.0, and you need to recreate your environment to look exactly like the customer's version. So how do you do that? Well, if you've got your Eclipse environment already set up, you'll be like, I have to go define a new server, and right-click on my application, run it on that one. It's a lot of work. If you actually have an embedded Tomcat, there's nothing to do. You just go into your source control, you check out that branch, and you right-click on the main program, and you run it. So just to prove to you how easy that is, I've got another example here. So this one, shut it off. And we're going to go to this guy right here. Demo 2, and run that one. And you can see that this one is launching Tomcat 7.0.34. How does it do that? Well, all I did to make that happen was change my my Maven build file to say version 7.0.34. My demo 1 version was using Tomcat 7.0.37. So that's just how easy it is. Nothing to muck around with, nothing to configure, it just works. So who'd like that? Other than me? So that's another good reason to do that. The third reason to do it is easier integration testing. So does anybody here have any tests that you require your Tomcat to be running before you run them? Maybe you've got some sort of like Ajax 2.0 or some sort of like client-side generation of content of your HTML, and you got a lot of RESTful web services that your browser is talking to. How do you test those things? Well, you got to test them probably in a running app server at some point. So it'd be really good to have a way to do that. Now, if you don't have if you don't have an embedded Tomcat, what you're going to have to do is you're going to have to start Tomcat with some sort of shell script. But then the problem you run into is, how do you know that Tomcat has fully started and your app is fully loaded? So that is a bit of a problem. So you kind of have to sit there like polling, trying to see, do you have some sort of status page? Is it there? Is it there? And then, okay, finally, I'll actually go test it. But if you have an embedded Tomcat, you can actually use the lifecycle information that the Tomcat objects give you to find out if Tomcat is started and if your application is launched. So let me just show you how crazy easy that is. I welcome questions, by the way, and challenges. If you disagree with me on these points, you know, go for it. Let me know.
I thought you were nuts.
Yeah.
But you're killing me here.
So in this example here in demo 3, what you're going to do, what we're going to do is, what was I demoing? I forgot.
Test.
Oh, right, test. Right. Yeah, test. So let's take a look at this guy right here. Here we've got ourselves a JUnit test. And I'm just going to right-click on this JUnit test. I'm going to go run as JUnit test. And I'm going to show you what my console says. My console showed you here, Tomcat launched. Now, I didn't actually put any test code here, but the stuff in black you see says put code to send request to Tomcat here. So you could literally, in your test, start Tomcat, run your tests, shut down Tomcat. Problem solved. Anybody like that? So that's another reason to do that. But that's good. I'll show you this code, like the actual details of the how later on in the presentation. So for now, I want to show you one more reason why, and that's the killer reason in my opinion. That's Git bisect. Who knows or has used Git bisect before? Who's never used Git before? If you've never used Git, raise your hand, okay? If you've used Git but you've never heard of bisect, never used it, raise your hand. Just want to get an idea. Okay. So Git bisect is something that I hope will blow your brain away for how awesome it is. So here's the problem that Git bisect solves. Let's say you've got something that's broken, some application. So in this case, I've got demo 4. And in demo 4, I've got a test. And let's go to demo 4 here to test. And let's run that. So, oh no, the test fails. The question is, this was working. I remember the last time I touched that code, it was perfectly fine. What could possibly be causing this code to be not working? Well, what would you do in this scenario? You could use Git bisect, yeah. You could use Git bisect, but if you didn't have it, you're probably trying to find out at what point and what commit did this thing break. So because Git has a direct acyclic graph, a DAG, starting at any commit, it can walk the graph back to any previous commit. So we can actually ask Git to find out the commit that introduced the test failure. Now, in order for the Git bisect to work, you're going to need to be able to start Tomcat and stop Tomcat, which is why having an embedded Tomcat is a really good idea. So how do we do that? Well, it's a little bit involved, so I'm going to show you the commands by just going to the shell here. Let's clear this out. Well, I forgot what I called the instruction file, so, bisect instructions. Right, so here are the steps that I'm going to follow, and as I go through them, I'll explain them. So first, I'm going to do a git log dash dash one line, and that is going to print out all of the commits that have happened on this repository. So as you can see, if you look at this, there's a commit here that says line four, make demo fail, right? That's the one that actually introduces the bug. But what we're going to see is how Git is going to find that that's to blame. So the way we do that is we can give Git a range of commits. So I'm going to say Git. OK, first of all, is this? Oh, my font is really not visible. So here, let's make it. Can everybody see it in the back? OK. So we're going to say git bisect start. And that's going to put git in bisect mode. And then we're going to say git bad. And we're going to give it the commit ID, which is we know at that point we have a bug. Okay? So I happen to know that, well, I know for sure I can pick anything after, you know, let's pick this one here. No, it's git bisect. Bisect bad. So we've told git bisect where the bad commit is. And we need to go back and say, OK, do we know at what point for sure it was working? Now, I happen to know that at this point, it was definitely working. So I'm going to take this git commit ID, and I'm going to say git bisect good. And it, what Git just did is said, look, there's eight commits between your good commit and bad commit. Using binary search, it's roughly going to take three steps to figure out where the problem is. So all we have to do is tell Git to run a command that determines what's going to happen or not. So I'm going to take this command here. It's too long for me to type off the top of my head. So we'll go and we'll type it like this. So let's go through it. So it's going to be git bisect run. And since I have a maven build, I'm going to say mvn-f and point it to the pom file. And I'm going to say to maven, please run the unit test. But I don't want to run all the unit tests. I just want to run the test that's called Tomcat test. So you could, when you have a bug, go and write yourself a test or a main program that launches an embedded Tomcat, and then basically fails or passes based on whether the bug is there or not. So once I do this, what's going to happen is it's Git is automatically going to check out and start the binary search process, build the application, run it, run the unit tests, and it will keep doing that. And it will come back with, aha, there is the commit that actually made the demo fail. Look at that. If I switch into my IDE, it's helpfully taken me there. And I just need to, egit is unhappy at the moment. So you can see that, I don't know if you can actually see it or not, but it says here it's in bisecting mode. If I go open it up, and you will be very surprised why my test failed. No, this is, I need to go to the right one. Oh, something is wrong with my demo.
Probably left you on commit before it,
yeah. So, right, hold on. Let me just do, let's do git checkout, and let's take this commit ID here. Okay, so there we go. And my test failed because I had very cleverly put an assert fail in here, just to demo it. So are there any questions about git bisect?
What should we do with the extra time?
I don't know. Just do whatever you want with the time you save, right?
What is the run doing? How does it tell git that?
So the question was, how does the run know whether the commit was bad or not? The answer is, by running the unit test, maven will either return zero if the process was successful, I think, or one if it's unsuccessful. So git is basically saying, run any shell script or any process and examine the return code. If it's a non-success return code, then just go ahead and forget about it.
Okay.
Mark it as bad.
How do you recommend it? If, say, even that, like, this test
if you had run this test when you checked it in, you would have known that failed at that point, right?
Absolutely, yeah.
So what if it's a new test that you created, so you got a bug, you created a test that reproduces it, but it doesn't exist in the previous history?
Okay, so the question was very good. The question was, okay, so I set this scenario up so that I did have a situation where there was a test in the history that would fail, and the comment was, well, in the real world, your automated build system would have caught that failure. So you wouldn't actually have a test. So in that scenario, what you would do is quite simply, you would create a new main program or a new test that did not exist before, and you would compile that test and place it somewhere other than your project, so it doesn't go back in history. So the script that you're using to run the command is not like compiled with it kind of thing. It'll involve a more sophisticated script. That's all. But I wanted everybody to get an idea of what git bisect is.
You can also use bisect manually.
I've always used it manually. I didn't know you could run automatically.
Yeah, I guess that is really worth to mention. That is, you can actually do the bisect manually. So instead of having the run, you can say, okay, I've checked it and it's bad, or I've checked it and it's good, and you can look that up on your own. But I hope people are impressed with git bisect. Anybody convinced to switch over to git? Okay, yeah, it's like okay. So that is the reason. Another reason why I think that you should definitely consider having embedded Tomcat. Okay. So the final reason why I think you should have an embedded Tomcat is because enterprise Java gets it all wrong. Its thinking is 1998. If you think about 1998, server hardware was expensive, especially if you're Sun Microsystems and you sell really expensive hardware, right? Software is expensive. You got to pay for all these databases, and you got to pay for the application servers, and you know there's lots of manual configuration steps, not just in the application server itself, but in how you configure the operating systems and all of the infrastructure. The development processes were generally slow. You're deploying every few months whenever you've finished a new release. Installing the app server is not simple. It's probably like a 10-page manual. And mostly the app server is in charge of configuration. So you're trusting the app server because you're saying, look, I want to cluster, so somebody's got to be in charge of where we keep all of the cluster's configuration. So for all these reasons, it was probably a really good idea to say that you deploy, you buy this one expensive machine, you buy this expensive app server, and you deploy as many applications as you can into this app server. So now let me ask the question. Today, who's deploying multiple apps to the same app server instance? Raise your hand if you do that. Okay, so we've got one, two, three people. Okay, who's four, right? Who's deploying one app per app server? Okay, other than me? Okay, so a whole bunch of other people. So if you look at the facts of 2013, commodity hardware is cheap and getting cheaper, right? There are a lot of zero-cost open-source software. So if you're running on Linux, or you're running Tomcat, or JBoss, or any one of the free app servers, there's demand for fast development process. Like a lot of places are doing continuous deployment several times per day, or at least once a week. Or you're definitely pushing stuff out to production a lot faster than you ever did before. In the cloud, you know. The process is the unit of execution. You know, the cloud monitoring software is going to be like, okay, start me a process. The process died. Restart it. Okay, I don't really know where this process is running. So what ideally you want to have like thousands of instances, you want to have one process that you can start wherever. Just one file that you say, go run it somewhere for me in the cloud. I don't want to have to install lots of files, have a very specific directory structure, then have to copy my code into this very arbitrary directory structure that somebody else picked for me, right? So for those reasons, what you really want is you want the application to be in charge of the configuration. You don't want the app server to be in charge. If you are in charge of the configuration, you can have really simple installation. And we're talking like about a DevOps world where you're going to even configure the servers themselves with things like Chef and Puppet. And you're going to automate everything so you can have thousands of servers, right? So if you embed Tomcat in your application, what you can generate is a single executable that you can just deploy that. Just copy it somewhere. What you'll have to do, though, is you'll have to manage your own configuration that's machine specific. But that's really good, because Tomcat really sucks for that anyway. And you can actually develop a much better scheme as to where you obtain your machine-specific configuration from. So it would know, OK, I'm running on server 1. Let me go do an HTTP get on my startup to download my configurations for that machine. Oh, and by the way, I could probably have that be somewhere secure. And I could, you know, keep all my passwords there. So yeah, on startup, you're going to need network connectivity. But well, you kind of need that for Tomcat anyway, right? So that's not much of an issue. So I think you can do much better with that. So let me show you just how easy it is to do this. So if I'm going to go here to demo 5, and I'm going to do git bisect reset. Oh, it doesn't like doing it. Oh, CD deep. Okay, what am I doing wrong?
Check out master with
There we go. Okay, yeah, we don't care about the bin folders. They're just not ignored. So, okay, so we're gonna go to TC demo 5, and we're gonna do cat instructions, and we're just gonna do MVN package, and off it's gonna chug, run the tests, build it all, and now. All you got to do is essentially do target.
Typo.
Ta-da! There you go. There's your application up and running. So if you actually go to the target folder, you'll see you've got a demo.jar. And oops. Well, that one is pretty tiny. Now, using your standard configuration, you know, whatever your build process is, you can imagine you can package a single jar file. You could put it on servers, like for distribution, other stuff like that. But you could certainly build a much smarter, more agile deployment mechanism than you could if you had to actually install and configure the app server first on the OS in order to then deploy an application to it. So in summary, these are my reasons why you should embed Tomcat. Number one, simplified development environment. Number two, eliminate the branch configuration pain. Number three, easier integration testing, easy bisect with Git, and simplified deployment. So if I've sold anybody that wasn't sold on Git, on Tomcat embedding, raise your hand if I've sold you. I just want to see if I succeeded. OK, I got a few people. All right. So that's cool. So now that I've sold you on why you should do a Tomcat embedded version of it, Let's take a look at how you can actually do the embedding. So there's three ways that you can do it. One is the using the Tomcat class, and this is a class that ships as part of Tomcat, and it's very simple to use, and it doesn't require any configuration files. So, but the problem with it is that the default configuration is not optimized for production. You wouldn't want to do that in production. It's perfectly fine for like having a running unit tests and local development server. So let's take a look at the code with that. We'll go and look at number five here. So first of all, how do you make it happen? You need to get the right things on your class path. And what that looks like is you specify the certain dependencies. So you go and you say to, for example, in your Maven, you say, I want the Tomcat embedded core jar file. I'd like the Tomcat logging with Julie, which is Java util logging, or you can use log4j. If you are using JSP pages, you can ask for Jasper to be included. If your app is just pure servlets and doesn't have any JSP pages, which is probably a good idea, you can just eliminate that dependency completely. And whatever else you need on your class path, like JUnit, Spring, whatever you happen to be using. So once you got the right items on your class path, it's a really simple matter to include it. Here's all that's involved. So let me put that up and give you guys a minute or so to read the code. Anybody surprised at how easy it is? Yeah, it's really simple. But you're getting like the default configurations for everything here. So that means you're not like the connector you're going to end up with is the blocking Java I/O connector instead of probably the non-blocking one or the APR one that you might want to be using. So that's how easy it is. And it also makes it really easy. You can like manually register servlets without a web.xml, and I'll show you that a bit later. So that's all there is to it. Okay. Any questions about this? Okay. So let me run this, and I'm going to show you something interesting about the class loaders for this. So something you're aware of it. Okay, so let's go here to localhost 8080, and so I've got this servlet here, and you can tell it's real because you can see the thread ID here actually increase, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? And what ends up happening is that this servlet is just going through the class loader hierarchy, and figuring out who's loading what classes. How many people here are familiar with the class loader hierarchy? Am I speaking like crazy stuff? Okay, all right. Who's never heard of the class loader hierarchy? Okay, all right, look, the basic gist of it is that in order to isolate Tomcat's code from your application code, they run in different class loaders. So that, for example, if you had a jar file that Tomcat also had on its class path, your application would see its version of that code, rather than conflicting with the one that's deployed into Tomcat. And that is not there. You're running, all of this stuff is running in the regular application class loader for Java. This is both really good and really bad. It's really good because you have such control over the class path that it's probably not going to be an issue. Tomcat has a good habit of repackaging its dependencies under org.apache.tomcat so they don't conflict with things anyway. So you'll be okay if you do that. So that's one thing. The other thing is you'll get much better hot code replace if you do this. So just something to be aware of. So that's one way to do it. And the second way to do it, any questions about this before I move on to second way? The second way to do it is the more braver and better way to do it. If you're actually going to do it for production, you're probably going to want to do this. essentially, Tomcat is a bunch of interchangeable components, and you can wire them all together yourself. However, so the pros with this approach is you have absolute total control over every aspect of the startup process. There's no configuration files that you need to get to use. You don't have to use the built-in configuration files or their layout or anything like that. You're in charge. You can read your configuration from a database if you want. You can read it over the network. You can, I don't know, like hard code it into the Java code if you want. It doesn't really matter. So the cons of it is that you do require a deeper understanding of Tomcat to pull this off. And it's the most complex approach out there for embedding Tomcat. And there's no documentation on how to do it. But there's the source code for Tomcat. So I've got a few slides here to kind of guide you on how to approach this. So even if you've never used Tomcat before, I hope I'll be able to explain enough of how Tomcat's internals for this to work. So the first thing that you want to understand is that Tomcat has a well-defined life cycle that it goes through. So I'll give you everybody like a minute and just read this slide. So hopefully that was enough to read through the life cycle. What's important about the life cycle that you want to understand aren't the steps. It's the fact that Tomcat is modular, and every piece of it is part of this life cycle. So for example, when the part of Tomcat that handles network communication is called the connector, and the connector obeys the life cycle, so it goes through the process of starting, new, initializing, starting, stopping, started. And the reason why they have all of these like detailed steps is that it can fire events during the startup process. So if you have something that you want to be initialized at the same time as the Tomcat connector, you could listen for events from that and do your initialization at that point. Essentially, if you have a dependency injection container like Spring or CDI, you wouldn't need something like this, but you have to understand that this was built in the days before dependency injectors were a commonly used item. And what's important to understand about it is that there's three things to it. When you look at a lifecycle object, it has getters and setters, and those are what you use to configure it. It has some lifecycle methods that say start it, stop it, and transition it. And then it has the methods that actually do the real work. And you're not supposed to call any of the methods that do the real work until you've actually initialized all the pieces. So you can call setters and getters all you want. So let me show you what I mean by that. Couple more slides and I will. And then the other things about the Tomcat lifecycle object is that all the stuff that does real work should only be called when all the objects are either started or after they've started. Okay. Here's a list of them, and I want you to just quickly read this list. So hopefully you've seen the pattern. There's an interface, and then there's something called standard with that interface name. The only exception on there is the connector, which isn't actually it doesn't have an interface that it implements. It's just an abstract class. And there are a bunch of other components in here that I didn't include to not make the slide very complicated, including things like the session manager. I don't know how many people know, but Tomcat's session manager is, you can like swap one session manager out and put a different one in. Anybody ever done that? Used a non-standard Tomcat? So there's a really cool one if you're interested on Google code which uses memcached to store all the sessions. So if you wanted a replicated session manager that's not even on the Java heap, there you go. You can use that one with memcached as the storage engine. But anyway, so Tomcat is quite programmable, but is very badly documented. Last thing before I dig into the code is that you have to understand that in Tomcat, there's also these things called containers, and the containers are all obeying the life cycle, but they have an extra two things to them. One is they have an extra request processing pipeline, so the part that actually handles a request is always a container of some kind. And then there's a collection of resources that every container has access to, like what's the class loader associated with the container, what's the session manager, what are the security realms, JNDI context, all sorts of other cool stuff. But they're kind of too detailed to get into right now. And the second most important thing about containers is that they're hierarchical. They have children. So if you start the parent container will start its children. And then those children will start their children, and those will start their children. So you have this like hierarchy whereby by controlling the top level container, you control all the things inside of it. So the best way to actually see this is to go look at the next sample, which is sample 6. Let's just make sure we don't have anything running here. And we'll go and this one, I'm going to actually run it through the debugger. And we'll just step through the code. So you'll see that this one is, the code for it is a bit longer. And I probably have all sorts of breakpoints in Tomcat internals that I'll need to kind of skip over. But that's true, yeah. You can just debug and you're in there, right? You don't have to worry about anything. Okay, so in this case, first thing I want to do is I want to tell Tomcat, look, where are you going to find all my resources? JSP files, HTML files, CSS files, whatever is in the web content directory or yeah. So I'm doing that relative to the current location and just pick up the absolute path name to it because that's actually needed. And then I start by saying, look, Tomcat has a context class, and I'm going to create a standard context, and that's the context represents a web app, and then I'm going to set its name to the default. Now you could set it whatever you want it to be. I give it a path mapping, and then I tell it, hey, web application, this is the directory you're actually going to find all your files in. Okay, good so far. And then you add a lifecycle listener, and this is the default web XML listener, which basically says, look, you know, if there's a web.xml file, read it. That's what that means. It reads the web XML file, parses it, and configures the context with the contents of that web.xml. At least that's what I think it does. I'm not 100% sure about that one. But I'm like, you know, 80% sure that's what it does. So. And then you can do other things that you could have done in web.xml, but you can do them yourself, like set the session timeout. Now, since we didn't configure a default web.xml, you're going to end up with like blank mappings for all the MIME types. So I've stolen code here shamelessly from the Tomcat class. And so I'm just going to skip over this. Well, we're going to put a breakpoint here. Otherwise, we'll be hitting F6 for a while. And okay, I'm going to set my welcome file. And now Tomcat also has the ability to use like these context configuration files that are application specific. So let me show you this one here. It's located in main web app right now, but I could have put it wherever I wanted to. And all I've done is I've defined a local data source just to Postgres, just to show you that you can actually do data sources and all the other typical things. And this is a standard Tomcat configuration file. So you'd have to read the Tomcat manual for how to do this. And let's go back to debug here. We have a few things running in debug mode. Ah, there we are. Let's kill this guy.
These pass in your source main web app, right?
Yeah.
That obviously works in Eclipse, but if you're actually running from a jar, is that going to work for?
Yeah, if you're running from a jar, you have to do a little bit more code. Yeah. But I mean, the point is, you're in charge. That's the key thing. You're in charge of what is actually going to happen. So we've got SRC main web app. Oh, wait, what happened here? Did we just go back to the beginning? Why did it do that? Did I rewind the stack or? Okay, apparently I rewinded the stack somehow. So we add the welcome file and we go through the context. And all I'm doing there is I'm telling it, okay, read this Tomcat specific configuration settings from this file. Once that's done, I tell it there's no default web.xml. Tomcat has this default web.xml that it inherits all settings from. So you could change the default timeout by changing default web.xml. If you wanted to, I could have pointed it at this default web.xml from wherever I wanted to, including the class path, I think. But I didn't want to make it too complicated.
Is that your constants file?
No, this is from Tomcat.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, the whole thing is like, the only code that I have that's mine other than main is the demo servlet. That's all. So wrapper is the internal Tomcat representation of a servlet. So now I'm going to go and I'm going to create a servlet and I'm going to add it to the context and I'm going to set the servlet name. I'm setting the servlet name, set load, set mapping. See, that's kind of cool. This is stuff you would have had to do in web.xml. You could just do it right there. Forget web.xml.
That's less convoluted.
It is actually quite less convoluted. Because, you know, web.xml isn't the prettiest XML file in the world. So now that we've actually, if we actually review the steps, what we've done, all we've done is we've actually configured a Tomcat application, and we've told Tomcat a bunch of things about this application configuration. Who's with me so far? Anybody got any questions? So now that we've got that, we need to get that application into a Tomcat virtual host. So look at that. We just create a standard host. And then we set the host name. I'm going to set it here to localhost because that's kind of useful for this demo. And then we add the application context that we just created as a child of this virtual host. If you actually are familiar with Tomcat server.xml, you'll see that the sequence in which things are being added matches the Tomcat server.xml configuration. So we'll do that. And now that we've done that, we now need to create a Tomcat engine. And a Tomcat engine can host one or more virtual hosts. In this case, I only have one virtual host, but I still need to create an engine, so I'll do that. And I'm setting a couple of properties that normally would be set by the shell scripts that started up. I'm not exactly sure why I need to set them. I think things will work even if I take them out, but I honestly didn't have enough time before this presentation to really figure that out. So we'll skip over that. So now we know this is where it's actually reading the base directory from. Now we can create our base engine and say to the base engine, your name is engine. Set the default host for it. Add a child to it. Add the virtual host to it. And then tell it what its base directory is. Now, the engine is, if you are going to set up a Tomcat cluster, this is the place where you would give the engine a unique JVM root and a bunch of other stuff. Generally speaking, if you're going to do this, learn how to do it with server.xml first so that you know that you can configure Tomcat to do that. And then you can go like, okay, what Java objects is Tomcat creating and what do I need to do to access them? So there's engine. Now that we've got an engine, the engine is actually what executes your servlets. But it does not do any networking. All of the networking is delegated to a Tomcat component called the connector. So what I'm doing here is I'm actually creating a connector so that we can accept network connections. And then I'm calling the get protocol handler on it. Now there's six different connectors that you can get with Tomcat, okay? And those are, I think, six. There's the standard HTTP blocking connector that uses Java I/O blocking. Not very good if you want to do like long polling or push notifications to your browser. There's a version that's written with the non-blocking I/O connector, which is really cool because you don't end up consuming the threads and locking them up if you're doing asynchronous I/O. That works really well. And then if you really want to, there's a version that uses the Apache APR. For those of you who don't know, when Apache 2.0 was released, the web server part, they extracted all the C code that handled like threads and concurrency, like semaphores and file system and SSL. And there is a Tomcat connector that links against this native code. So if you were to run Tomcat with the APR connector, you're literally using the same C code that the Apache server uses. Now, if you did that, you get some advantages, like, well, you're running C code for SSL, for one. You get other disadvantages. You got to compile it for the architecture that you're running on and got to do some more setup and all that stuff. But you can do that if you want. So the point is that the reason why I have this protocol handler here is there's all sorts of settings like timeouts and things that you want to configure in the networking, like say what's the minimum compression size. And I'm just showing you here so you can figure out how to actually do it later on if you actually try to do this. Then I set the port on the connector, so it's going to listen on port 8080. And that's me setting up a connector. Any comments at this point or questions? Yeah?
So compared to server XML, do you have more options here, or is it the same?
You have the same exact options you have in server.xml, except that you don't have to, like there's a lot of things in server.xml that are just defaults that you would never change anyway. And if you were, let's say you were making a product and you were selling it, right? Your customers are going to install Tomcat, but you don't want them to know that. You want a really simple configuration file where you say, you're running my product on your server. My configuration file is going to have three settings. Number one, what's the IP address to listen on for the port? Tell me the port, okay? Tell me where your SSL certificates are and what's the password to get at it. And this way, there's like all of the complexity of server.xml is hidden from your customers. They would never have to see that. If you've got a public-facing web app or something like that where you're in charge of deployment, that's not as much of an issue because you can develop the internal expertise for server.xml. So I don't know if I answered your question or not. But
no, that's it.
Yeah.
So you're really not getting any advantage. Like everything you're doing here, you could just do through the XML file.
Yeah, of course. Okay. Yeah. Obviously. Because look, what the XML file is doing, what Tomcat is doing is it parses the XML file and then does these very same things that you're seeing here. And I'm going to show you after we go through this demo where to look in Tomcat's code base to see how Tomcat parses the XML file so you could replicate whatever the XML file is doing.
Is there any Java doc on this?
There are Java doc on the APIs. And you know, some of it is incredibly useless. Like it will say background processor delay, and then it'll say, this is the background processor delay. It's like, okay, that was useful, Tomcat developers. Thank you very much. You know, I could have read that from the variable name, right? So there's a lot of that kind of documentation.
We can get 100% doc coverage by generating the docs.
Yeah. In fact, it's so interesting. There's that book called Clean Code, and it's a really great book. And in the example chapter on bad comments, there's like a listing from Tomcat for bad Java doc. So, okay. So now so we've got an engine, and we know that the engine is where Tomcat processes all the requests. And we now have a connector that can handle networking. And what we need is we need to connect the connectors to the engine that's going to process the request. So what we do is we create a service. And in the service object, we specify the engine. And we specify the connector. And you notice that there's only set container. It's not an add container. Because you can only have one engine per service. But you can have any number of connectors. For example, you can have an HTTP connector and an HTTPS SSL connector. So that's one way to do it. You can have multiple types of connectors. Why would you ever want to configure multiple types of connectors? There's plenty of reasons to do that. You could configure one type of connector that's strictly for management of your application. So have one connector listen on the external IP address. And then if your threads are all locked up because somebody is doing a denial of service attack on you or something like that, you have your management connector where you can administer Tomcat or your own application running on a separate IP address that's not visible to the outside world, that's on a separate network, for example, if you want to be that fancy. Okay, finally we get to the part where we've got a service. Now we need to create our server. So I'm just going to create it, set its... So the port here isn't the port that you're listening on. It's the shutdown port for Tomcat. The default is -1, which means it doesn't listen for a shutdown port. So just ignore this for now. We add the service, and here I'm adding the Jasper. I'm adding Jasper, which is the JSP engine, so that Jasper would launch and configure itself as Tomcat is launching. So this gives you an example of the modular nature of Tomcat, whereby as something is starting up, it can you have an opportunity to configure yourself. Next is a is this enable naming method, which I stole from the Tomcat class, the embedded one. And what it does, it configures JNDI for you. Okay, now if you are embedding Tomcat, you don't have to use JNDI if you want to. It's kind of a little bit more complexity that you can get rid of, should you choose to. But this just copied from there. I don't quite know what it does. Sets a bunch of properties for the JVM. So when you go new initial context, those properties are there for JNDI to find them. Okay, now we're done. So we're actually going to start the server. And okay, now we're into breakpoints in the code itself. So let me go back one up to my main method here and put a breakpoint here and just hit resume a few times. Okay. So now we're going to get into something really fun that you can do. If you start Tomcat yourself, you have access to all of those Java objects that represent Tomcat. So you can ask them questions, like, let's go in here and see what we can ask them. We can go to the server and say, okay, server, find me all of your services. And I can get a list of all the services that I've configured in there and kind of go through them, print them out. So you can see here that I found that I've got one connector. I can look at the thread pool executors, find out how many thread pools are configured, and you know, potentially obtain all the details of their configuration and include that in a status report for my app. And then you can print out the containers. Now the containers have a parent-child relationship, so I had a little bit of just a recursive function to print that out. And so you can see in this application, let me just finish, let it run through to completion here. You can see that there was the server was the top level container. It had a connector. There was an engine at the same level as the connector. And then the engine had a host, one virtual host in it, which had one standard web application, which had four servlets in it. The info servlet that I installed, and the JSP servlet that compiles JSP pages, along with the default servlet that's just a built-in default servlet for serving out static resources. So if I now go to my localhost 8080 info and I refresh this, I have a breakpoint in the pipeline that does the processing. So let me just go back to my debugger here. And where's my debug controls? Let's just let them through. Okay, so you'll see it eventually prints out got a database connection, and it really did get a database connection. Okay, yeah, right. So here's the really cool part about this example. There's no web.xml. There was no web.xml at all. Boom, boom, boom. No, this is Tomcat demo 6. Webinf is empty. Now, you can get rid of WebXML with Tomcat 7 just using web Servlets 3.0, but I wasn't using Servlets 3.0 here. Like, I mean, I just said there was no component scanning going on to look for all of the at web initializer stuff. I don't think so. Maybe there was. I don't know. So the point is, like, takeaway point is I think it's worthwhile for you to configure an embedded Tomcat. We're still in the process of bringing it live for our application, and it takes a bit of time and mucking around to get it working, but for the reasons that I outlined at the beginning, I think it's worth doing. Anybody got any questions about this so far? Yeah?
Do you know how much is different Tomcat 7 versus 6?
Not much of a difference in the classes and code I looked at. In fact, even if you go back to Tomcat 5, a lot of those pretty much are identical. The interfaces haven't changed in forever. So those are, as far as, like, for example, if we look at server, and this is one of the other advantages of doing this, of doing an embedded Tomcat, because if you use Maven, it's just going to link the source code to it. So you'll just be able to go in and, you know, take a look at it. And you can see all the Java docs for it. This is like kind of part of the core API. I've looked at the Tomcat 8 code. It doesn't look like they've changed this. So can they change it? Probably. But, you know, I think the time savings you get and the simplicity that you get is worth the pain for one or two people on your team to take this kind of task on to get all the benefits. Right. Good question. Anybody else? Any questions?
Well, let's say you're running 20 apps.
Sure.
How much do your requirements increase by running 20 apps to Tomcat?
So the question is, I'm running 20 apps, and how much would my requirements increase if I'm running 20 Tomcats? I mean, I don't know that it really would. Like, you're running more processes on your servers. I don't think that's going to be a problem. In terms of memory, you could probably give them less memory, each of them, if you're running one app per. And I mean, the reality is you can have an embedded Tomcat that runs multiple apps, right? I was just making the observation that when you're running multiple apps, those apps shouldn't be talking to each other, even though there's ways to make the session shared between them. Not a good idea. I don't think there's much of a difference. It's just sliced differently. That's the short answer.
Okay.
Yeah.
One complication would be that each process can't listen on the same port as another.
Yeah. Yes, that's right. That's right. Yes, that is right. That's correct. So, yeah, you will have to pick different IP addresses or, yeah. Yeah, I mean, like, it depends if you're running some sort of HTTPD load balancer or something in front of it. So you, by doing this, you are bringing on yourself the task of managing the ports and the IP addresses and all that stuff. But my thoughts are that that's actually easier if you're in charge of how you do that, rather than being forced to say that the place where you set the IP address and the port number to listen on is server.xml. It's a lot easier for a process like this to launch, connect to a configuration server, download some configuration file that tells it what port and IP address and all that stuff that it should listen to, which you can't do by default with server.xml because it expects server.xml to be in a certain directory. Now, you could use a network drive for that to read server.xml, which would work, but then you have to configure network drives, and if you're doing some sort of cloud-based deployment where the instances can just disappear, it gets a little bit more complicated. So yeah, so I don't know. Personal opinion is I wish enterprise Java was more like this by default, so it doesn't matter what app server you're using, you could take charge of it and be in charge of how to start it in a standard way. And I think ultimately they will have to do that for the cloud. Because on the cloud, you have to be atomic when you deploy your configuration settings. And you don't know where you're running. And you can't basically say there's 15 XML configuration files and then try to copy them somewhere, but only 13 of those files work because the network link went down. And then they get out of sync, and then you've got to change them. And it's just, you have to have that ability to guarantee that all the instances have the same code, the same configuration. It's non-trivial. You know, WebSphere uses an agent architecture to do that. JBoss 7 redid their whole infrastructure to allow you to have these, like, management server, which distributes to all the other stuff. And I'm sure they're doing some sort of transactional distribution of configuration. I'd like to avoid that by just sending one file. And yeah, anyway. But that's a conversation for another day. Any other questions before I tell you where to look for what server XML is using? No, I don't. I'm just using Maven, and they're being pulled from Maven Central. So the only thing that's in source control is the web palm.xml. So if you're using Maven, that's all you need. If you're using Ant, you could just pull them down with the get command in Ant and the Ant script, and just pull them from the network or pull them from Maven Central or wherever. Or you could check them into source control if you wanted to. You know? And then if you switch branches, they'll probably have a different set of jars. But, yeah. Great question. Anybody else? Any other questions? Okay, so if you want to replicate what server.xml does, what you need to do is understand that Tomcat uses Apache Digester, which is a very old package for reading and parsing XML, and it exhibits every bad thing that you've ever heard about Java as far as software design goes. It's literally one of the most evil packages I've ever seen. However, it is also the reason why Tomcat does not have an administration console, because Digester can only read the XML, it can't write it out. And it gives you really horrible error messages, and it doesn't really understand XML schema, as far as I know. A much better way for them to have, a much better way approach would have been to like use an XML schemas with namespaces, with like some sort of JAXB or some sort of mapping, because look, parsing this XML file is a one-time operation on startup of the app server, and being able to read it in something that can serialize it back to XML would be great, because then you could change those settings on some sort of GUI and then save those back out, which you can't do right now, which is probably the reason why JBoss forked Tomcat's code base, because they would have had to rewrite all this to build their nice new GUI that they have for Tomcat's for JBoss 7. So anyway, it's broken. So if you go looking in the Catalina example, so you go to the Catalina class, and then you go to start, okay, no, it's, what was the name of that method? Begin digester, what was it called? Create start digester. I love the name. Create start digester. So basically the way digester works is, just so you get an idea of it, is that it's basically going to read the XML file, and you program it with a bunch of rules. So you say, look, if you see an XML element called server, then what you should do is look for an attribute on that XML element called class name. And whatever value is in there, create an instance of that object using reflection. And if there is no class name attribute, well, use this class name here. And then after you see that, set the next item to call the setServer method on the server object. And then after that, look for an element like underneath server called global naming resources, and create an instance of it using this class. And then go and set some properties. So if you read about digester, and then you read through the source code here, you can actually find out the exact algorithm that's being used by Tomcat to parse the server XML and then create all the stuff. So that's why I was saying get something working with server XML first, and then you could do the whole advanced embedding. Okay. Comments, questions? Okay, so, don't say it. I love PowerPoint. It's still running. Look at that. So in summary, I think this is probably was the last slide anyway. You can do it one more way, which I really didn't have time to finish the demo for you. And the idea is to call the Catalina class and call the start method. So you would end up starting Tomcat the same way that the shell script start Tomcat. The pros of this, you can use your existing configuration files, but maybe throw them in a different directory and try to not go through shell scripts or something like that. The cons is that you still have to maintain a complex directory structure, and you still have to use the Tomcat configuration files. And my demo doesn't work, but there's some starter code there if you want to hack with it. So in summary, how to embed Tomcat, three choices. Use the Tomcat class, wire it up yourself, or try using Catalina. I hope that the main takeaway is at least set it up for development. It doesn't really hurt you if you use it in your unit tests, and if you run as during your just regular development, you could still deploy to a standard server XML configuration. And when you're more adventurous, you can go for that. So yeah, that's my presentation. Does anybody got any questions? Okay.